before I begin the sermon this morning, I want to share something with you. We're going to start recording the sermon separately each Sunday so that I can download that on our YouTube page. Because there are some people that don't want to watch the whole service but would love to hear the sermon. So you can search FUMC Mertzon or Mertzon Methodist, I think, on YouTube, and you'll find that page. So anyhow, just want to let you know. So we're going to continue our series on outsiders, outcasts, and outlaws. And this week, we're actually going to talk about the final week of Jesus' life. So I want to start out by asking you a question. I asked myself this question. I was kind of surprised. If you knew that you had 1 week to live, what would you do? Where would you go? And who would you spend your time with? I'd go fishing. I'm supposed to get a laugh out of that. No, actually, I never really seriously thought about this. But as I contemplated this, I realized that the first thing that I would do is I would pray for my family. I would ask God to take care of my family, take care of all the financial details, the emotional details, the spiritual details, whatever. The next thing I would do is pray for my church and pray the same thing. And then I would spend that rest of that week with my family camping and fishing. Because that's what we love to do. There's just something about getting out in nature and just seeing the beauty that God has for us and spending time together in nature. Now, my wife won't go with me if I leave in the morning to go fishing. But she knows I'm probably not going to come back till dark. So a couple of those days, I'd have to start out in the evening. But most importantly, I would spend that time with the Lord. Amen? Amen. You know, during the last week of Jesus' life, he knew what was coming up. He knew the beating was coming. He knew the suffering and the pain and the humiliation that was coming. He knew the cross was coming. He knew all of that. And what did he do? He kept doing what he'd been doing for 3 years. He kept taking care of the least, the last, and the lost. He kept teaching God's love and God's word. He kept speaking truth. Even though he knew that he was going to be brutally persecuted for it, he followed the Father's plan to the letter, to the T. Why? Because he loves us. He's dedicated to us. And still is. He sits now at the right hand of the Father on the throne and intercedes for us. Amen?
Mm-hmm.
Amen. So today, like I said, the title of the sermon is Final Week. I'm going to do two scriptures, but I'm going to start out with Luke chapter 19, verses 1 through 10. If you want to follow along in the pew Bible in front of you, that's in the red Bible, that's on page 82. In the blue Bible, it's on page 100. And as always, I would encourage you to listen when you hear the Word of God spoken. Not just listen, but listen with your heart. Listen with your mind. Because as it says in Hebrews chapter 4, verse 12, the Word of God has power. Power to transform us. Amen?
Mm-hmm.
So, hear what the Lord has to say today. Then Jesus told this story to some who had great confidence in their own righteousness and scorned everyone else. Two men went to the temple to pray. Am I in the right place? No. I had it marked. That was a previous sermon. Don't excuse me. Jesus entered Jericho and made his way through the town. There was a man there named Zacchaeus. He was the chief tax collector in the region, and he had become very rich. He tried to get a look at Jesus, but he was too short to see over the crowd. So he ran ahead and climbed a sycamore fig tree beside the road, where Jesus was going to pass that way. When Jesus came by, he looked up at Zacchaeus and called him by name. "Zacchaeus," he said, "quick, come down. I must be a guest at your home today." Zacchaeus quickly climbed down and took Jesus to his house in great excitement and joy. But the people were displeased. "He's gone to be the guest of a notorious sinner," they grumbled. Meanwhile, Zacchaeus stood before the Lord and said, "I will give half my wealth to the poor, Lord. And if I've cheated people on their taxes, I will give them back four times as much." And Jesus responded, "Salvation has come to this home today. For this man has shown himself to be a true son of Abraham. For the Son of Man came to seek and save those who are lost." This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Okay, we know that Zacchaeus was a tax collector, but he worked for the Romans. He worked for the Jews. He worked for the Romans. And not only was he a tax collector, but he was a chief tax collector, which meant that he would collect taxes from the other tax collectors. And, of course, we know that when the tax collectors collected, they always collected extra money. So they could make money. They kind of skimmed off the top, I guess you'd say. But Zacchaeus did the same thing. So that didn't make him a real popular person in society. In fact, people hated him. I imagine Zacchaeus was probably always afraid for his life, even. But what he did made him very wealthy. Extremely wealthy. But the money, that I'm sure, didn't make him happy. In fact, it made him an outsider. People might have even called him an outlaw. I'm sure he felt like an outcast. His life had to be difficult, to say the least. But everybody treated him bad, except for one. Except for Jesus. Jesus treated him as a beloved child of God, just like he treated everybody else. And that day, when Jesus called out to him and called him down from the tree and said, "Zacchaeus, come on down. We're going to go, and I'm going to stay at your house today." Can you imagine the look on everybody's face? "What? You're going to go stay at the house of a chief tax collector? Probably the biggest sinner in our village, in our town? What are you doing?" But that didn't stop him. In fact, Zacchaeus wasn't the only tax collector that he did that for. In chapter 5, he calls a tax collector by the name of Levi to actually be one of his disciples. He even went and ate dinner with him. And all the rest of the tax collectors, "Boy, you didn't do that. No, that was a huge number. Because he loved them just like the rest. It says in Luke chapter 15, verse 1, all the tax collectors gathered around Jesus to listen to him. And the Pharisees and the legal experts didn't like it, they grumbled. Just like they grumbled when he called Zacchaeus down in the tree. They really grumbled when this one happened. But by what happened, you can tell what Jesus was doing that day. When he said, Zacchaeus, I'm going to go spend the night with you. I'm coming to your house. Everything in Zacchaeus' heart changed at that moment. The moment that he met Jesus, and the moment that Jesus showed everybody that he too was loved and loved by Almighty God. His whole heart changed. So he said to the Lord, he said, if I've cheated anybody out of taxes, I'll tell you what, I'm going to repay them back four times what I've cheated. And not only that, now here's how you can tell his heart really changed. I'm going to give half of everything I own to the poor. What? Here's a man that had taken from them for who knows how long, who was hated for who knows how long. And that day, in public, that all changed. As wealthy as that man was, that was a lot of money. A lot of wealth. And he gave half what he owned to the poor. And how did Jesus respond? Well, this one's important. He said, today, salvation has come to this man's home. For the Son of Man came to seek and save the lost. Today, salvation even came to this man's home. And I don't mean the building. I mean here. In here. I wonder how many other ones that had their lives changed, their hearts changed that day. There's no way to know. But that was the Lord's mission. He said, I came to seek and save the lost. And here it is in his final week of life. And here's what he's doing. Making a difference. Following the Lord's plan. He even rode into Jerusalem on a donkey. It had been foretold hundreds and hundreds of years before that day by the prophet Isaiah. Isaiah says, rejoice, O people of Zion, shout in triumph, O people of Jerusalem. Look, your king is coming to you. He is righteous and victorious, yet he is humble, riding on a donkey. Once again, Jesus turns everything upside down. Once again, Jesus does the unexpected. You see, kings didn't ride into towns on donkeys. They rode into town on these big, bold, beautiful stallions. And they had all this beautiful armor on. And I'm sure they probably even had a battalion of soldiers when they rode into a town. Not Jesus. He did the opposite.
on himself and rode in on the donkey just as the Father had planned. And his soldiers were sinners, tax collectors, fishermen, even a doctor, ordinary people. They didn't have any armor on, except the armor of the power of God. They didn't ride in on the stallion. In fact, they walked behind them. And everyone rejoiced as Jesus was riding in to Jerusalem. Everyone realized the prophecy was being fulfilled. And they shouted, "Hosanna! Hosanna! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord! Hosanna!" But it didn't last. After that, some things changed. Jesus even did a thing or two that people probably thought was crazy. He went into the temple and he drove out all the people that were selling animals. He went to turn the money changers' tables. And he said, "You people are making my house a den of thieves. I won't have this." Wonder what those who were standing around watching what was going on were thinking. This is the Messiah? I'm not sure I know about him. But they didn't realize that what Jesus was doing is he was acting on behalf of the poor. What he was doing was taking care of the outsiders, the outcasts. Because they were the ones being cheated by those who sold the animals. And you had to have temple money to go in and do the offerings in the temple. And they were charging them exorbitant prices and rates. That's why he was angry. And you know, everybody paid taxes. And the Pharisees tried to trap him. They went to him and said, "Okay, we know we're supposed to pay taxes. What about these taxes that we pay Caesar? What do you think about that?" And he asked, "Do you have a coin? Let me see a coin." He picked the coin up and he said, "Whose face is that on the coin?" And they said, "Well, Caesar's." He said, "Okay, give to Caesar what's Caesar's and give to God what's God's." That didn't work. And as they went by the part in the temple where everybody put their coins in these cans and made all this loud noise with their offerings, and a lot of people, you know, the upstanding Pharisees, the big religious leaders, you know, they got all these small coins, huge amounts of them, poured them in, so they make a whole bunch of noise. Remember the widow? She only had two small coins. All she had left. He pointed her out to his disciples as she dropped the coins into the metal container. He said, "I tell you the truth, this woman has given more than all the rest of them because she gave all she had." In other words, she gave her whole heart. And to Jesus, that's what matters. And then he celebrates the Last Supper with the woman. He tells them what's fixing to happen. He tells them that one of them is going to betray him. He tells them that he's going to be arrested. He tells them that he's going to be rudely beaten. And he's going to be killed. And as they sat there, they were confused. They didn't know what to say. But then something changed. The next thing you know, they start arguing among themselves as who's the greatest among them. And you'll find that in chapter 22, verses 24 through 27. And you'll find this in the Bible, in a few Bibles. In the red Bible, it's on page 87. In the blue Bible, it's on page 105. And once again, I invite you to hear God's word. This is what was going on. Then they began to argue among themselves about who was the greatest among them. And Jesus told them, in this world, the kings and great men lord it over their people, yet they are called friends of the people. But among you, it will be different. Those who are the greatest among you should take the lowest rank, and the leader should be like a servant. Who is more important, the one who sits at the table or the one who serves? The one who sits at the table, of course, but not here. For I am among you as one who serves. Once again, this is the word of God for the people of God.
And thanks be to God.
I don't know. I mean, when I read this, my mind boggles. And I don't understand what was going on. Of course, I know a lot more than the disciples knew back then. But it just really boggles my mind that as they sat there and Jesus said, I'm going to be arrested. I'm going to be beaten. I'm going to be put to death. The next thing they do is argue amongst themselves who's greatest. I can't fathom that. They had to be confused. They had to be totally confused. That's the only explanation I can come up with. But, as always, when that happens, Jesus didn't criticize them. He didn't scold them. He didn't jump all over them because, hey, what are you doing thinking about yourselves? Don't you realize what's fixing to happen? Instead, in love, in godly love, he turns that around. Uses it as a teaching moment. And he opens up their eyes to see who really is the greatest in the kingdom. And that would be one who serves in love, in selfless love, just like he came to do for us. And he did that on the night before all the horrendous things were fixing to happen to him. He kept doing what he'd been doing. He stayed on his mission no matter what. Now you've got to realize that he was human. Okay? He experienced pain. He experienced suffering. He experienced everything that we can experience. Yet he was filled with the Spirit of God. Remember when he went and asked the disciples to go with him when he was afraid? Asked them to stay with him, and he walked a few steps away. He began to pray so hard that he sweat blood. And ask the Father to take the cup from him. Because that pain was fixed to be horrible. And he knew just how horrible it was going to be. But he didn't stop there. He finished the prayer with, "Not my will, but thy will be done." Because he knew how much it meant. He knew how much it meant for you and me. And I thought about this before, but it really hit me this week. You know, being a man, understanding the pain, understanding the humiliation, understanding all the suffering that was fixing to happen, he could have become scared and run. It's a possibility. But he didn't. He did it for us. So I leave you with this question. What are you willing to do for him? What are you willing to do for yourself? And what are you doing, willing to do for the people around you? We've got a lot more than a week left, I hope. And I pray. Because there's important work to do. But it's work of love. And it's work that means too much. And sometimes we feel like we're not worthy of that. But the truth is, God makes us worthy if we're willing. If you ask Him to forgive you for your mistakes, for your sins, ask Him to come into your heart and to lead your life sincerely, and continue to pray for that guidance, watch out. Things like Asbury will happen. I'm seeing them all around me. You know, thank you to God for them all the time. I thank God that Jesus Christ stayed on mission. We need to too. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen.
Let us pray.